Well, good morning. It's good to see all of you. Hey, first, I better introduce myself. I'm the other Pastor Mike. Actually, I am also the East Ohio District Camp Director. Sometimes if you look on Facebook, you'll see me sitting in the office in the main chair. I make all the major decisions over at the camp. Because the other Pastor Mike, he really doesn't know what he's doing. I've heard a lot about you good people. Pastor Mike has told me that you are a wonderful family. He loves you. And I could not wait to get here this morning just to meet you for the very first time. Hey, listen, Miss Laura is going to help us out this morning open the service. So, Miss Laura, will you come? Or if we already came. My glasses are not that great either.
Well, I am excited to be here, and we just wanted to go over a few things that the kids have been learning back in junior church. And so we've been doing the parable of the pumpkin. And if you haven't read it, I have the book if you would like to borrow it and use it. But we've been talking about, Pastor Mike, the pumpkin and how the farmer is like God and picking us out of a whole patch of people because he thinks that we are that special, that he wanted to make sure that he picked just the right pumpkin for the job that he had in hand.
Miss Laura?
Yeah.
Am I special?
Yeah. You are. You are very special.
Oh, thank you.
That's why you're the bus driver, okay? So we have the pumpkin that the farmer had picked, and he washed it off. But it wasn't good enough just to wash it off on the outside because it could roll around in the mud and it can get dirty again and all those things. So God, the farmer, had went down and the pumpkin let him open it up and clean all the stuff out, all the guts. Just like us, God cleaning out our heart and all of the sin. And so this was what was on the inside. Would you like to smell it?
Well, listen, I've been looking at that for a couple of weeks. It's gross.
It is gross. What's on the inside of our heart needs cleaned out. Because if not, like this, it grows stuff, and it reaches out and ends up infecting other things and making those things go bad. But did you know, Pastor Mike, sin sometimes tastes good.
Yes, it does.
Sin sometimes smells good, and it looks good. When we opened up this pumpkin, man, the nice aroma from that pumpkin smelled really good, and it was a little slimy and a little gross, and some of the kids didn't want to touch it. But we got it all out there, and then we cleaned it all out, separated it, the sin, the what was good out of there and what was bad. That's like what God does with our hearts. He cleans it out because there are good things in there, and there are things in there that he can use, but there are also things in there that he wants us to get rid of and to ask him for forgiveness. So in that process, God gives us a new face, a new outlook on life, and then he places his light within our heart. Drop that down in here. And because of that, this great light shines out. Pastor Mike, you have that light in your heart, and you shine out for others in ways that only you can do. I shine in ways only I can do. You all shine in only ways that you can. And God puts that in there. He picked us out for a purpose, and he uses us for a purpose. Now, we also have this pumpkin, Pastor Mike. You know anything about that pumpkin?
Not really.
Well, sometimes we don't allow God to use us in the way, but we put on a face. And we try to make nice, and we want to look nice on the outside. It's a cute little pumpkin, but it's not going to do the same for this world that this pumpkin is going to do. Because this pumpkin thinks that it's put on what it needs to. It has put on, when I was little, man, actually up through my teen years, I put on the face. I knew how to act. I knew how to dress. I knew what to say. and I knew how to do it and who to do it in front of. And but that was not getting my heart cleaned out, and it was not changing me for God. You kind of know a little bit about that. You did not let God at first open up your heart all growing up into your adulthood.
Yeah, nobody told me about it.
Yeah. So we, a lot of us put on this face and it doesn't do what it needs to do. We don't do what we need to do for God. He picked us for a purpose. He picked us for a plan. So we have gotten rid of the stuff in our heart. If you've asked Jesus into your heart, he's given you a new face. His light is shining in you. But out of those, out of the sin, and he picked all the good things, God changes those things for something beautiful. And so back on the table, we have a little craft for the kids to do today. The pumpkin seeds that we took out of the pumpkins, we've dyed them and changed them, and we've made something beautiful out of them. And that's what God wants to do for you. He wants to change you. He wants to take all that sin out of your life, and he wants to use it for a good purpose. And God has really changed Pastor Mike's life. He changed ours. We both have a totally different story. I grew up in a Christian home. I knew what to say. I knew all the Bible stories. And I knew God's what God's plan was. I just didn't choose to do it. Pastor Mike grew up in a beautiful home, but he did not grow up in church. He did not learn about Jesus for a long time. Now he had a granny and a mom that instilled great things into his life. But two different ways that we've grown up, both God chose for a certain plan, and he chose to bring us together to help fulfill his plan. And I believe with my whole heart that God sent us together for a reason and gave us great seeds, changed our life to make a difference in others. So we have back on the table as you come in, we have pumpkins with a pumpkin prayer on it. We have a craft back there for the kids to do today. And kids, if you see me after service, I also have the treasure box.
Listen, I'm going to see her after service.
I think you should. Well, Pastor Mike, thank you for helping me today. If there's something else you want to add, you
no,
go right
I just
ahead.
I'm glad to be here, and thank everybody for coming today.
Yeah.
Thank
all
you,
right.
Ms.
Have
Laura.
A great service today.
Yeah.
Well, that was a special treat this morning.
No, you guys are going to move it during.
Be hard to top that. I'm trying to figure out which one of us are the dummies up here now.
I'm going to ask that you all stand and join us. We're going to sing some songs, and we are very thankful that you are all here this morning. Just
has taught us great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. The purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son.
The other of the screen, we're just gonna sing and praise the Lord.
You are holy,
you are holy,
you are mighty,
you are mighty,
you are worthy,
you are worthy,
worthy of praise,
worthy of praise.
I will follow,
I will follow,
I will listen,
I will listen.
Just a couple of announcements. I'm going to start with my slides first. Thank you, ladies, for all that came out yesterday. I call it my pumpkin day. But thank you so much for all who could come, and I'm sorry for those who couldn't. You know, we know life happens and health issues and, you know, just general family things. So, you know, I'm sorry you couldn't make it, but it's okay. We had a great time yesterday. I believe I counted 11 of us. If you could go to the first slide. We had a fantastic time. And I know it's probably hard to see, but that's who made what pumpkin that you saw when you came walking in the front foyer this morning. A couple of people made two because we had plenty of pumpkins. But that's all of us with our pumpkins. And then if you go to the next slide, we just had a great time. Laura brought in her electric utensils. She had her drills and all kind of things, and she was just having a great time. And a lot of us painted, some of us carved, and it was just a fantastic time. If we go one more, that's the picture out front for those that aren't here. That's what you saw out there. And these are all the ladies that came yesterday, and we just had a good time. We started it somewhere around 10, a little bit after 10, and we just painted and fellowshipped, and we had some food and fellowship, and it was just a fantastic time. I think I have one more. If not, it's okay. That's all right. But for those of you that couldn't make it, I hope next year you can come, because it is a great time, and you do not need any experience whatsoever. You don't have to carve. You can paint. You can draw. You could do whatever you want with your pumpkin. Lori Ridgway yesterday, she painted hers all blue, and she brought in her tablecloth that had some seashell things on it, and she just snipped them out and she put those on it. Again, you do not have to have tons of creativity, just come with an idea, or even if not, you just come and have a good time. So thank you for all of you who've come. In the back, behind this section of rows of chairs, sorry.
We have a pumpkin patch.
There is a pumpkin patch. For anyone who couldn't make it or would like to take a pumpkin home, I don't care if you make pumpkin pie out of it, I don't care if you want to carve it, whatever you would like to do, feel free to take a pumpkin. There's also some little tea lights. If you want to carve and stick a light in there, you can take a light. Take them home with you. Just enjoy them, because that's what they're there for. They're one of God's creations, and they're good to eat. They're also good to look at. So feel free to do that. The last few things I want to remind you that today is the last day for Pastor Appreciation. It doesn't have to be the last day, but it's the last day we're going to leave our box out. So if you forgot your card for Pastor and Laura, just bring it into them. But they're going to take their box and whatever's back there home with them today.
Can I just interject?
Yes.
This is not the last day we're going to appreciate our pastor.
That's true.
Okay. It's just officially.
Because October was officially Pastor Appreciation Month. So, yes, today is the last day we're physically going to put a box out. But, yes, I agree. We have enjoyed Pastor Mike and Laura being here, and I will tell you, you know, for those of us that have been around for a while, it's been some rough days. It's been some rough years, and it's nice to have a family that we can love on again. Amen. And that is here for us. Amen. And that is being here to be our pastor and wife and family. There's a lot of things on the back of your bulletin and inside your bulletin. Please read them. The one quick thing I just want to point out for kids, caravan is on November 11th at noon at Canaan Acres Camp. Okay, so I'm corrected. It's this next coming Saturday. So it's the 5th of?
4th.
4th of November. So the 4th of November for any kids who are doing caravan, it's going to be this Saturday coming up at 10 to noon. And then the other thing I just want to point out is Thanksgiving dinner after service, November 19th. I mean, it feels like it's not that far away, but it really is far away. It's right around the corner. Okay? So put that on your calendar, and it's always a good time. It's a lot of food, and just being together as a church family for an afternoon is fun and exciting, and we get to eat.
Can I interject a point?
Feel free.
Okay. Here's the story. It will make my life a lot easier. Okay, because my wife, I kind of just put her name out there that she would be in charge of this. So if you love me, Next Sunday, we're going to have a sign-up sheet for all the different things that we're going to have on the menu. So we're anticipating that next Sunday it's going to be filled, okay? And it'll be great. We're going to have the whole dinner. We're going to do the Thanksgiving dinner. Because some people don't have family and stuff to be with, so they're going to be with us as our family, okay? And we want to encourage you to come and invite your friends and loved ones. And we're going to come as close to gluttony that day as we can get away with, okay? And we're going to trust Jesus for his love. And so we're looking forward to it. So please, please, please come on the Thanksgiving dinner.
Okay? That's right. Well, that is all I have, unless there's anything anybody else can remember. And so I'm going to ask you to stand and take a few minutes to greet each other. I'm going to ask that you grab your last hug, last handshake, last greeting, and make your way back to your seat. There is something very important I forgot this morning. So I had my wonderful boys, and I'll include my husband in that for a moment. They went out there this morning and they looked at all the pumpkins, and I asked them, decide, you know, give me three, right? Well, little did they know I didn't want my name in there, but I couldn't tell them which one was mine. You didn't have to stop playing. You could keep playing. But I kind of asked them, you know, what's your top one, top two, top three? Well, I hate to say this, but their top one and top three was Emily and I, so we're going to take our name out of the race. But I'm going to ask Laura if she'll come up. We do not do yesterday
you
for a
were
prize.
Second.
It's just to have fun, okay? But I enjoy giving something out, and last year it was Dixie. But Laura, this is for you. They picked your pumpkin as being the nicest one out there that they enjoyed looking at. But they are all exciting and wonderful out there. So if you didn't have an opportunity, take a look at them on your way out. But we're going to continue to worship and praise the Lord this morning.
Such a powerful song.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written,
us.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to read. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim. Christ.
more song, Pastor. It's just a little chorus that most of you probably know. But it's Jesus' name above all names. As we prepare to pray, it's such a beautiful name. He's glorious Lord Emmanuel. He's God with us, blessed Redeemer, and living Word. Let's sing that together.
Jesus, name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord, Emmanuel, God is with us, blessed.
Together. Father, we have just sang praises unto you. We recognize this morning how awesome you are, how wonderful, how loving. You are our hope, for you are our creator. In fact, Lord, everything around us, Lord, you have created. You are the one who can calm the sea and can pick up mountains and throw them into the sea. You are everything. We come before you this morning and we stand here in awe, recognizing the fact that you are the God who chooses to come and be among us. Sometimes, Lord, it's difficult for me to understand how you would choose to come into this broken world, even in the midst of all the darkness around us, in the brokenness of lives, and you would say, here I am. I love you. I want better for you. I want to hold you up. I want to change your life. I have a plan and a purpose for you. Lord, you come in the midst of that, and Lord, you do these wonderful things. You bring healing to the body. You bring healing to our emotions. Deliver us, Father, from chains that have bound us for years. You have set us free to live out your purpose for us. You help those that are mourning. Lord, we know that you have an eternal plan. Lord, I even read in your word again this week where you said that eternity is set in our hearts. You created us to live forever in your kingdom. Lord, we have that desire. We know it's not possible without you. You are our saving grace. And so, Lord, as we lose those that we love, sometimes it's difficult for us because it's wired in us for the right now. Yet you know the eternal plan. And so may those that lost this week know the hope, Lord, that you can bring in a difficult situation. We thank you, Father, for our church. And I was thinking, Lord, as we were singing together this morning and we were singing about you, how many people have come to the knowledge of you as their Savior through the ministry of those that are here this morning. Lord, your word says that some of us plant seeds. Some of us get to water them. Others get to be a part of the harvest. I'd be willing to say, Lord, if we would think that all of us have had a part in leading somebody to you. Help us, Lord, to do this. Lord, in this service, bless us continually with your presence, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
You may be seated. And the ushers are going to come, and when they do, TJ and Emily are going to sing a song, and I'm going to spill just a little bit of Pastor's thunder this morning, but we're going to have a baby dedication, and when I start thinking of that, I start thinking of my own kids, and I'm very, very thankful that they're here with me this morning. I know that one day they're going to move, and one day they're going to go out on their own, and they're going to be a part of their own churches, and that's okay. It's going to be hard. You know, I know a lot of you have been there. You've done that, and it'll, we'll get through it. But I'm treasuring and cherishing these times when they're here, and they can sing as they were practicing this morning. I was sitting over there because I'm not doing anything. And to see how God has taken their lives. Someone who never wanted to stand up in front of a church and sing in his life said, no way, I'm not doing that. Don't get me up there. Don't want to play my trumpet in front of people. No, 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 no. He today will stand in front of you and he will sing and he will give his heart because he gives his heart for God. And as we go through this baby dedication, I want to remind you that it's not the parents' whole part to raise their child. God has given those children for each and every one of us in this church to hold and love and to care for. And I'm so thankful through the years of the churches that I have been, that that is what the congregation, the people, and the body of Christ has been to my kids. And even though there are people outside of this church who are still giving and pouring into my kids, and I'm so thankful for that. Because it's us in these pews. It's not, as I said last week, God is not this church. He doesn't just live here. He doesn't just live in our homes. He lives in us. As Laura said about the pumpkin, we have to let our light shine. And so as they sing this morning, it's called Firm Foundation, and God will never fail us. And for those that are still praying for miracles to happen, they might happen because God is in control. They may not happen the way we want, but God will take care of it. I shared with Pastor, and I know I'm taking forever, I'm so sorry, but I shared with Pastor this week on Friday that Thursday we received notification that Tom's brother's son, Caden, who is 18 years old, had two major seizures. And they took him to the hospital and had a CAT scan, and they found he has a 12.4 millimeter, I do not know how big that is, but a 12.4 millimeter tumor on the left side of his brain. I don't know how deeply rooted they're into church because they don't live near us. But God has a plan. He has a purpose. They're going to do surgery on Monday, and whatever God's plan and purpose is going to happen. Again, maybe not how we want it to be, but God is still in the miracle-working business. And for those of you who pray, who've prayed for your children, continuing to pray for your children, or those in your life that God is trying to reach, God has a plan. Like Pastor said, some of us plant, some of us water, and some of us reap the harvest. But ultimately, God is in control, and he won't fail.
Around me shaken, I've never been more glad. I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I've built my life on Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down, he's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. Was built on you, and I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it through.
Oh, rain came and wind blew, but my house was built on you, and I'm safe.
Rain came and wind blew,
TJ and Emily, that's a great introduction to what I'm going to be talking about this morning. In Matthew chapter 19, Jesus talks quite a bit about children and the importance of children in the kingdom of God. Children have always been a very important part of the ministry that God has called Laura and I into. A lot of people don't know this. Even people have known me for years, but several years back now, at one point in pastoral ministry, I had contemplating leaving pastoral ministry, going back to school, and becoming a children's pastor. And I prayed about that and sought wise counsel from a dear friend of mine who is now pastoring a church in Indiana who is very much also involved in children's ministries. And he said, I want to just counsel you, pray with you, and give you a word of advice. He said, we need pastors who believe that children are an important part of the church. And from that point, I began to realize that God had placed me in a unique position with a wonderful person in ministry, Laura, who is like incredible with children. That we could do what needed to be done to raise up the church through children. Our first pastorate, we started with 7 widow ladies, and Laura started a caravan program in the church. Literally, that caravan program built that congregation. I can go back and I can show how working with children on Wednesday night brought families into our church. We were at our last pastorate for some time, and I started to realize that we had young adults going out the door and not coming back. And I went to Laura and I said, we got to stop that. That's not good. And so we prayed about it, and this was the decision that we made. We decided that we would start discipling children from the nursery to their elementary years, all the way into their youth. As a result of that, if you stay at a church long enough, you can see the outcome. I saw children rise up, become adults, become leaders in the church, board members, those that are involved in ministry. I look at this particular congregation, although I don't know all of your stories yet, I do know some of your stories. Grateful to Rob and Katie for bringing your children to camp. They're very much involved in the church today. Tom and Heather, I've watched your children grow into fine young adults. I knew them when they were kids, I knew them when they were youth, and now they are leaders in the church. I see that all over. And it is a blessing to be a part of raising up young people to leadership in the church. And to know that our church has a love for children. You know, some of my fondest memories are children that would come up the center aisle while I was preaching and shake their finger at me and give me what for. And I would just keep preaching. Even times reaching down and picking one up and holding them through the message. But to look back now that some of those children now are involved in the church and are leaders in the church. I don't believe it's an accident that Jesus, when in Matthew chapter 19, the disciples were saying, hey, look, get them kids out of here. Jesus hasn't got time. Jesus got a little upset with him. He said, no, let him come. Bring him to me. And then the word says he laid hands on them and he blessed them. And we don't know the outcome of that. We We have no idea the outcome of that. You know, I would like to know the stories behind those children that Jesus laid hands on that day. I would be willing to say that some of them became great leaders in the church. I would be willing to say that's what happened. Because Jesus took the time to love them, to hold them, to bless them. Reading in Matthew chapter 18 this week, I've read it over and over again, and I thought how interesting. We've been preaching from the Beatitudes, and blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And here we have Jesus here in the 18th chapter of Matthew, literally speaking about the meek, children. In most cases, children are meek. I've met some children with some big attitudes. I've met some children that were very profound in their theological understanding and didn't know it. Because there's the simplicity of the way they understand things. Sometimes we try to complicate things. We want to make it sound really like big, and a child comes along and says, but this is what it really means. One of the things that beginning in preparing for ministry, I'll never forget, I was preparing for ministry, and they said I had to write a paper and prepare a sermon to preach to children. Do you know how difficult that is? I still let Laura do that. Because she's so good at it. I mean, she can preach regardless. I wouldn't have a problem saying, Lord, just take over. But man, she is so good at sharing the message with children in a simplistic way. And children are simplistic. They will tell you what they think. And they will love you. They will love you completely. Unless you give them a reason not to. They will trust you. Unless you give them a reason not to. I guess I've been accused of not staying with the script, and I'm not going to. I'll never forget when my granddaughter, my only granddaughter, I tell her she's my favorite granddaughter. She was just little. And we were down in West Virginia at my mom and dad's church for a gathering, and my mom had taken my granddaughter to the park. And my granddaughter loved the sliding board, like so many children. And she was sliding down the sliding board, and Grandma was trying to catch her at the bottom and doing fine. And then Grandma got distracted. And here come Reagan. Well, for a little while, she didn't trust Grandma to catch her again. They'll trust unless we give them a reason not to. And children seem to know what's real sometimes and what's not real. I look at this passage that Jesus is talking about here in Matthew chapter 18. And one of the things that he says to us is that we're not to do anything to cause them to stumble. You think about the responsibility that we have as believers, that we're being watched. We're being watched by those around us. We're being watched by children. We're being watched by youth. Particularly today, they're looking for authenticity. They are. They're looking for the real deal. Jesus said that if we would do anything to cause one of these little ones to stumble, that a millstone would be tied around our neck and we'd be thrown into the sea. Cause that much damage. He goes on to say that these children, and I believe that we're all children, have our own special angel watching over us. You know, I really never thought about that. But all the years that I would, you know, Miss Laura said it a little bit this morning in her story. You know, she grew up in the church. I didn't grow up in the church. I've shared some things with you. All the years that I was a child growing up, I realized there was a presence there protecting me, overseeing me. I mean, I knew that presence was there. I can go back on those moments, those times, when I knew something was there with his hand upon me. I'll do something a little unique this morning at the close of the service when we bring Harper up to dedicate her. I will talk about that. And then in conclusion, in this conversation that Jesus has with his disciples, I believe it's here in the 14th verse of the 18th chapter. He's not willing that any of these little ones should perish. I mean, do you think we're all children? We're all God's children. And he's not willing that any of us should perish. I want you to know that he's looking on that individual that you may think is the worst individual out there. And Jesus really wants that person to come to him like a child and allow him to change their lives. He wants to redeem them. He wants to forgive them. He wants to give them a new life. I think of some of the scoundrels over the years that we've looked at that are so evil and so mean and have done so things that are horrific. Yet Jesus looks at that individual with hope and thinking, if they would just come to me, I could change their lives. I could give them real purpose. It would no longer allow the evilness that's controlling their lives, but it would be the goodness of God working through them. There's so many. And I think about those who come in and out of the church and the responsibility that we have. I look back there this morning, I see a bunch of children back there. I have no idea, and you have no idea, who those children are going to be in 20 years. The leaders that they may become in the church, the missionaries that they may go forth into the world and share the gospel. One of them sitting in our church this morning might become a great political leader, anointed by God. We have no idea who is in our presence. I don't often think of those things, but there are times that I do. So I'm not going to take much more time. I'm going to ask if Josh and Nikki would come forth with their family. Of course, Harper, would you come? Is she still in the room? Oh, there she is. Nikki told me she was a little grouchy this morning, but I saw a smile on her face. Every time that I'm involved in a unique and kind of special service where we dedicate, we marry somebody, we ordain somebody, whatever kind of special service it is where God is involved, I always think of the opportunity that we have to rededicate our lives. Every one of my children were dedicated to the Lord. My father-in-law, he taught me that and then, of course, Laura, she said, we're going to do this. And I learned over the years what dedication meant. Dedication meant I'm giving that child back to God. And I'm taking my hands off. I'll never forget that I listened to a missionary at camp one year talk about her call and how her parents had dedicated her to the Lord. And when the time came for her to make a decision for God in her own life, God had called this young lady into the mission field. And her parents, of course, were not happy about this situation, because that meant that their little girl was going to go to the other side of the world. And so they did everything they could do to prevent that from happening. Their little girl got sick, very sick, was dying. The parents went to God and said, "Well, we dedicated her to you." And God quickly reminded them, "Yes, you did. Then why are you not letting me use your little girl for her plan and her purpose?" I do not believe that God caused that little girl to get sick. But I believe that God used that situation to get those parents in the right mind. They turned their daughter loose, they released her, and she became one of the great missionaries in the Church of the Nazarene. So when we dedicate our child, we're saying, "God, you gave them to us. We are giving them back." So, before we get too excited, you want to help? Hold that for me. Good deal. All right. In presenting this child for dedication, you signify not only your faith in the Christian religion, but you also desire that she may early know and follow the will of God, may live and die a Christian, and come into everlasting blessedness. In order to attain this holy end, it will be your duty as parents to teach her early the fear of the Lord and to watch over her education, that she will not be led astray, and to direct her youthful mind to the Holy Scriptures and her feet to the sanctuary, to restrain her from evil associates and habits as much as it lies to bring her up in the nurture and the admiration of the Lord. Will you, now this is your part. Will you endeavor to do this by the help of God? If so, answer, "I will." Now I'm speaking to you, the congregation. I now ask you, the congregation, will you commit yourself as the body of Christ to support and encourage these parents as they endeavor to fulfill their responsibilities to this child that assists by nurturing her growth towards spiritual maturity? If so, answer, "I will." Something I like to do in situations like this is I like to anoint the child with oil. We know in the church that we believe that this oil is symbolic of the presence of the Holy Spirit. We also believe in the prevenient grace of God. We believe that God is with us even before birth, that God walks with us all the days of our life and does everything he can do to get us back to him. And so this morning, I'm going to anoint Harper with oil. And I'm anointing you, Harper, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. We'll get it. And what I am saying is that you are God's child. I have no idea, Harper, what God is going to do with you in your life. But I am believing with all my heart that you will become the young lady that God has called you to be. You do what you do best. I love it. Let's pray. Father God, we know that you're here. We have testified of that truth this morning. I have anointed Harper with your oil. I have prayed your presence upon her life. I know that you will be with her, that you will remind her, even though she will not be aware of this day, you will remind her of this day until the day that she has to personally make a confession of you as her Savior. Lord, we pray this, we believe this. We pray your hand upon Harper's life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Congratulations. You did good. Good, good. All right. Gosh, bless you, brother. Bless you. And bless you.